Welcome to EPJ Pathshala. I'm Dhiren Boisa. Today, as part of Resource Geography, we are going to talk about the module Resource Development and Environment, Global Trends Since Industrial Revolution. And while we are going to talk about it, we are going to fulfill few of learning objectives. A, we'll try to understand what have been the geographical basis of industrialization and its spread. What has been the emergence of fossil fuels and the global consumption, and how has it propelled the industrial age and the modern lifestyle? What is the relationship between, say, industrialization and the global changes in the population and the emergent demand on finite resources? What is the nature of this resource in use and the pressures on the environment, raising on the question of sustainability? So what we are going to do today, we're going to talk about a story. And this story is going to be the story of human civilization. At different points of history, we have consumed and produced different kinds of tangible and intangible resources. From as hunters and gatherers, to agriculturalists, to industrialists, and the modern age and the modern civilization that we quote. History and geography of humankind is also the story of resource consumption. It is a history of the development of these various tangible and intangible resources that have propelled the course of human growth and development at different points of time. From the consumption of wood, wind, and water in the pre-industrial phase as primary sources of energy, to the ushering in of the fossil fuel consumption with the emergence of coal, petroleum, and natural gas. The basis of economic growth have undergone drastic changes. These relationships that we are speaking about are in the terms of dependent population. How the growing population also implied growing demands on the natural resources. How does it represent spatial inequalities in terms of not just these demands, but between industrially developed countries and developing world? And what are the pressures of such on the issues of environment? Say, consumption of different resources at different points in time has had certain impacts on environment. What impact has industrialization have on environment? And we are going to talk in terms of energy consumption, issues around climate change and carbon emissions, ozone depletion and spatial inequalities therein. The flow of the lecture is going to be like this. So initially, we'll start to establish industrial revolution, where it started, how it spread out to different parts of the world, what kind of resources fueled this industrial revolution. Next, what we are going to talk about is what is the relationship of this industrial revolution and the way it spread across the world on the growth in population. Is there a relationship? Further, what we are going to do is, if there is a relationship between industrial revolution and, say, growth in population, what implications does it have on, say, environment in terms of carbon emissions, in terms of global warming, climate change impacts, etc.? Simultaneously, we're also going to talk about the global flow of energy consumption, trying to exhibit how the shift from renewable sources of energy to non-renewable sources of energy like fossil fuels, coal, petroleum, natural gas, triggered and changed the entire human history. And while we speak of this, we speak by this consciousness that today, unlike any part of human history, there are more number of people inhabiting the Earth's surface. And that number of people inhabiting the Earth's surface is more a product of last 200 years. Then what happened in this last 200 years? Or say, a time little earlier than last 200 years. We start our story in late 1700s. Late 1700s is the period when the Industrial Revolution first knocked at the doors of Great Britain. and how it changed the geographies of resource consumption. And what we are talking about is how new technological innovations were adopted and how these new technological innovations changed the lifestyle of people, what kind of social and political ramifications they had, how they increased the production capacity, how that increase in production capacity was not just in terms of, say, industrial products, but also in terms of agricultural productivity, something that led to mechanization of farming, something that led to spread of high-yielding varieties of seeds, chemicals, fertilizers, and pesticides, and that sort of technological innovation that triggered in possibilities of increasing food supply. And when we say increasing food supply in correspondence to growing population, we mean the issues of food security. And how the story was not just limited to food security, but how the implication of industrial revolution was also on health issues. How that industrial revolution was also about medical revolution. How scientific thinking penetrated into the way we treated diseases. Not forgetting that how newer forms of diseases were also discovered at this time. However, what happened was a lot of diseases, a lot of calamities that we thought were natural, that we had no command over, now we could change. Now human beings felt a little control over the way environment function, the nature function. So what happened in Industrial Revolution? One significant element that happened in Industrial Revolution was shift from wood, wind, and water to coal, petroleum, and natural gas. Late 1700s, but it took next 100 years till 1800s, the way it spread across not just Great Britain, but Western Europe, and reached to the shores of the United States of America. Until 1960s, when it has become so humongously, so intricately part of human psyche, that we can't imagine development without talking about industrialization. We can't talk about development without talking about consumption of coal, petroleum, and natural gas. Now we're going to talk about what then was the reason why it happened in the way it happened in Great Britain and nowhere else. What was so special about Great Britain geographically? A, Great Britain at that time was an imperialist country. B, Great Britain had enormous supply of coal and iron ores. And being an island country, it had a long coastline. And this long coastline would then imply that not just it is immune to any external threats, but it also has a cheap mode of transportation. This was also the phase of human history when we saw emergence of railways and roadways and canal as waterways as cheap modes and faster modes of transportation. You had raw materials from colonies, you had colonies at marketplaces. So Great Britain had everything possible going good for it to have industrial revolution. Now this industrial revolution had a ripple effect which spread to Western Europe and how it was smuggled into the United States of America. How new kinds of goods were developed. The commodities that we consumed diversified. Textile industry came into place. But what it also did was the rift between capitalists and the working class extended. If you were poor and the Industrial Revolution occurred, you became worse. But if possibly you had economic resources, that you had control on some capital, then the fruits of Industrial Revolution were all pleasant. There was a geography that developed in terms of geography of production of natural resources and consumption of natural resources. But what is relevant for us while we are talking about in context of resource depletion? It is the relationship with growing human population. What happened to human population? if one were to divide human history or population history, since we scattered from Africa to all parts of the world the way we diffused till today, that we have almost 7.5 billion people inhabiting the earth, first century AD only had, say, 150 to 200 million people inhabiting the earth. And most part of human history, the growth rate of this population was very sluggish. That at the dawn of the Industrial Revolution in 1700s, the population of the world was only 700 million people, reaching only 1 billion by 1800s. And even within the sluggishness of growth, we also could imagine the wrath of nature was so much that in 1300s, some 75 million people died out of a plague outburst. And that was called the Black Death. In last 200 years, or last 100 years, if one were to just look at 1900 to 2000, the population of the world has tripled from 1.5 billion to 6.1 billion population. Now, if one were to divide this population history, we can say a phase of pre-modernity, which was the longest part of human history where population grew sluggishly until the Industrial Revolution, where the second phase triggered of the industrial era, where population grew really fast. And the growth of this population was due to the improved health conditions and better standard of living, that most of the countries were having population growth rate of 2.1% up till 1960s. And the third phase of population growth, where the post-industrial, or where we say when we have industrialized world, where most of the industrialized countries, which bore the fruit of the first fruits of Industrial Revolution, started showing decline in population. However, this also meant that a lot of the developing world, which was now receiving the fruits of Industrial Revolution in form of better health facilities, medical facilities, hospitals, disease cure, etc., had reduction in death rates, but high birth rates. Now, this high birth rates and low death rate implied that the gap between them was very high. Therefore, the population growth was extremely high in developing countries. Now, that implied that this exponential growth of population, which Malthus talked about, would also lead to exponential demand on resources. And because it was the industrial world, the demand was more on non-renewable sources of energy. And the increase in productive capacity that triggered out of this exhaustible non-renewable sources was of unique nature. This uniqueness came from the fact that for the longest period of time, when we started using those inexhaustible resources, we thought coal, oil, and natural gas will never die. We'll never get exhausted. And when we realized that it's going to end, it was the time when possibly our human society or the development paradigm was so interwoven with the consumption of fossil fuels, the only way we could think out of the consumption of fossil fuel was to resort to expensive modes of technologies, unforeseen modes of technology, new substitutes as renewable modes of technology. If one were to look at human history, one interesting part happened in 1970s when the oil crisis triggered the Middle East and the oil prices just raged up the world. And because most of the world was using oil to run their cars and trucks to transport and railway networks and whatnot, that we felt that there's something enormous catastrophe that is going to happen. And this is not out of a sudden. It was in 1949, there was an American scientist called Hubbert who had predicted this happening. He said that somewhere in 1970s, the oil production is going to reach its peak. And once it reaches its peak, it's going to diminish thereafter. Now, what happened in America at that point of time? That American government said, oh, okay, we are going to launch a new project. Now we'll call this Project Independence. Now this Project Independence was independence from the excessive import of oil and natural gas for which they were dependent on this cartel of OPEC countries. oil producing and exporting countries. So they invested heavily on nuclear power plants. And they say a time will come when this nuclear power plant will become, it's become so cheap, so less polluting, so less contaminating environment, that we will not have meters in the houses. So instead of having meters in the houses, we will have a standard rate that we will send electricity bills to every house. Well, it was very soon that the American government realized that amount of raw materials that you need, uranium, plutonium, etc., and the kind of technological advancement one requires, and the kind of radioactive waste that was generated out of this technology, was very hard to maintain. That it was this myth of nuclear power plant was too soon to collapse. Now, why are we talking about that there was a sudden rise in population since Industrial Revolution? What is this, how it is related to when we talk about resources, resource development and environment? The relationship is the relationship with carrying capacity. Now, how did Earth's carrying capacity get affected by Industrial Revolution is what Martin talks about in terms of technological innovations and agricultural revolution, in terms of green revolution technology. Now, what happened was, suddenly there was a boost in food supply. Now, one should also realize this increase in carrying capacity has a certain limitations. And it will also exhaust until unless we use and devise certain sustainable methods to do it, to resolve the issue of energy crisis. That one will have to rethink on the way the global energy budget uses this non-renewable sources of energy. So let's briefly talk about what change in terms of energy, in terms of global consumption, happened post-industrial revolution, since industrial revolution. A, it happened that in the pre-industrial era, say Europe, because it's where the industrialization first triggered, renewable energy sources were the first. They were dependent on renewable energy sources. And most of the energy demand came from animal traction. That is, like, they were dependent on horses and oxen for their energy. Now, we cannot say for sure that consumption or dependency on, say, horses and ox was a sustainable mode. However, it was drastically different from consumption of coal, petroleum, and natural gas, which could now support more number of people, rather than the limited number of people and limited yield which the animal traction could produce. What also was required was we needed huge amount of wood, because we were dependent on wood or charcoal that we learned to produce. Now that led to enormous amount of deforestation and lower efficiency levels in terms of sustaining the growing population basis. What happened in the industrial era was this shift from renewable to non-renewable energy not just increased production capacity, but with simultaneous increase and betterment of health facilities led to triggering in the population base, and that triggering in population base led to increase in demand or dependency on the limited power resources. The urban centers that developed out of industrialization around coal mining areas and iron ore mining areas, where all these mining cities came up, also became the grounds for lucratively attracting people to migrate from rural areas. Right. Since 1960s, the consumption of oil and natural gas alongside coal has drastically increased, taking care of the majority of the energy needs of the world, with modern energy sources growing by 700 times. So for the longest period in human history, biofuels have been stagnant. It's from 1820s onwards, biofuels have remained, however, the amount that we have consumed of them. However, since 1960s, there have been rush in terms of fossil fuel consumption. So coal, petroleum, natural gas, nuclear power, etc., has increased drastically. Not just we have not tried figuring out other alternative modes of energy source. But most of these energy sources have also been expensive and not easily convenient at the present rate of the growth pattern to easily shift to those. What it has also done is this industrialization has triggered issues around pollution. Increase in carbon emissions. Greenhouse gases have been released into the atmosphere, linking it to the issues of global warming. And raising issues around, say, climate change, where we are still figuring out how at different parts of the world is differently reacting to the way this increase in carbon emissions has, or what we say carbon footprint, has changed the way we imagine the resource consumption map of the world. That the era that we live in, what we call modern, the kind of standard of living that we enjoy, going to areas of mass consumption, consumerist culture, one needs to realize that most of this is dependent on this fossil fuel consumption. That all, let's say, while only 17% of the world population lives in developed countries, they consume as much energy as the rest 83% of the world consumes. If one were to look at the figures of 2014 by World Bank, 81% of the world relies on fossil fuels for its energy needs, triggering ecological challenges of rapid industrialization in form of the very limited resource base of the earth and growing population post-industrialization react to each other, with increasing in demand for resources for satisfying human needs. And second, how this industrialization based on fossil fuel consumption has raised a host of ecological issues around pollution, poverty, carbon emissions, greenhouse emissions and global warming, hazardous waste disposals, drinking water contamination, health hazards, etc. New forms of diseases have come. Let's briefly talk about what are these ecological issues. Let's start with global warming. The simplest explanation to global warming would be increase in the world temperatures. Now, when we talk about global warming and when we're talking context of industrialization, what we're saying is that this global warming is a human-induced global warming. That the trigger to this global warming, the increase in the world temperature, is a product of the release of a certain components on the in the atmosphere that absorb the incoming solar radiation, thus raising the overall temperature condition of the Earth. Now, this overall temperature condition, increase in temperature condition of the world, has serious ramifications. One can be, and is much predicted by various studies, including IPCC, is melting up of polar ice caps. Now, what will happen once the polar ice caps melt? The sea floor or the sea surface will rise. An immediate effect would be submergence of lot of coastal regions, including several island countries. And if one were to look at population geography of the world, a major proportion of the world population is dependent or lives on the resources or the land of these coastal areas. So coastal areas have historically, because of the kind of geographical relationship that we have, in terms of trading patterns, in terms of economic growth poles, have been the centers where population has been high. The other ecological factor, ecological influence of industrialization has been in terms of climate change. Now, world temperatures are not just raising, but there are global cooling and global warming. There have been changes in the monsoonal patterns. That areas which had humongous agricultural productivity, very high agricultural productivity, are slowly showing growth at diminishing rates to a sense of land degradation. What has also happened is that we have released a lot of pollutants, and those pollutants in the atmosphere, in the water bodies, a lot of which we also consume as drinking water, has led to triggering a lot of health hazards. It can be skin ailments, it can be asthmatic attacks, it can be all kinds of newer forms of diseases that we are just discovering. And therefore, an enormous amount of research and development money is going into curing these new diseases. Diseases that probably were never existing before. The other issues that raise are of land degradation. Also, how this industrialization has increased the gap between rich and poor, the working class and the bourgeoisie, and thus producing various kinds of poverties, both social and economic poverty. Also, leading to acid rains, etc. Let's briefly summarize what we just talked about in this lecture. We said that industrial revolution was a product of a massive shift from energy consumption from A, renewable sources of wood, water and wind to consumption of fossil fuels like coal, petrol and natural gas. Now what happened was this shift led to increase in carrying capacity vis-a-vis increasing technological knowledge, increasing human population worldwide, especially in industrialized countries with effective reduction in death rates. Now while that effect of rising population in developed countries has come to a halt, one can see the implication in developing world where the population base is so high that even the diminishing rate of population would mean that we are adding more number of people every year. That the production of commodities that for matter earlier relied on manual labor or animal power drastically increased because the entire production process had been mechanized. This led to increase in production capacity, further infusing and benefiting growing population, and thus leading to increase in demand on natural resources for satisfying human wants. Simultaneously, what urbanization did, what industrialization did, that it propelled urbanization. How new these industries drew a lot of out-migration from rural areas, which changed significantly environmental conditions by putting excessive pressure on resources, growing level of pollution, contamination of resources, enhanced rates of carbon emissions and greenhouse effect, global warming and climate change, widening gap between rich and poor, developed and developing worlds. This increased consumption of fossil fuels also meant reliance on exhaustible resources that caused overconsumption and accelerated rates of depletion, causing alarming signals for future use and calling out need for sustainable and clean resource development and consumption. Thank you so much.